is Vicki Riley, and I will be your worship leader this morning. I would like to welcome you to Calvary Gamber on this beautiful Palm Sunday as we begin our walk with Jesus through Holy Week. If you'll take a moment, please, and fill out the cards in the pews noting your attendance, they will be collected during the offertory later. If you have any questions about Calvary and our missions here, please feel free to see Pastor Beth or myself at the end of the service. Let us now prepare our hearts and minds for worship by listening to the prelude and observing the bringing in of the light. Please rise as you are able to join in the call to worship, followed by the opening hymn. The story of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem tells us that after his celebrated arrival, he went into the temple and looked around at everything. As we gather here for worship today, may it be with a sense that Jesus has walked in too and is looking around. May our eyes be open to see him. May our hearts be ready to be seen by him. May our worship be worthy of his presence. And may we be transformed so that we see the world through his eyes.
Thank you. want to lift some invitations and celebrations in the life of the church. If you have your bulletins, the insert there, there's an extra insert. Today is the last day to pre-order flowers for the youth flower sale. So make sure you get those forms. You can either put them in the offering plate there, or you can order online through tomorrow. We'll be actually placing the orders on Tuesday morning. So please support the youth as they head out on mission this summer to Frostburg. We're really excited to be going. We're still looking for a few more students to go and adults. And so if you're interested, please let Miss Gail or I know. In front of you, you'll also notice there's an addition to your pew pockets there. There is a directory that has been printed. Those are going to stay in the pews, okay? It's nice to be able, especially if you're visiting and you want to recognize somebody, they can look at the pictorial directory and figure out who you're worshiping with. But I'm going to say, if you want to take yours home today, you can take it home, but you have to take one of those cards that's right behind it, the Easter card, and you're going to use that to address it to someone in that directory that you haven't seen in a while. Just put a stamp on it, put it in the mail, write them a little love note on there, say we miss seeing you, whatever. So take the directories home. We will replenish them this week, and so we'll still have those for us to be using in the pew pocket. So feel free to take one home, but take an Easter card home and invite somebody. It is a proven fact that I think it's 90% of people will respond to an invitation when it's given by a parishioner and 10% when it's invited by a pastor. So I don't know if that just means I don't hold very much weight in your eyes, but go ahead and invite and extend that invitation for Easter for our friends that we haven't seen in a while. We're beginning our love offering for the month of April for the Wall of Hope and for our youth mission. So this summer, we're heading to Frostburg with Camp Hope. And so on the back in the sanctuary where we have our coffee hour, you'll notice we actually have a Wall of Hope. The way this is going to work is as you are making contributions this month, we'd like to recognize those who have given in support of the youth and mission. So we'll be putting your names on those bricks. You can still put your love offering envelope in the offering plate as it comes around, or you can give online and just denote in there that it's for the love offering. So we're very, very thankful for your support in all those things. Next weekend, busy weekend, we'll have Easter egg hunt, yeah, everybody excited about that? Easter egg hunt, we'll be gathering at 9:15 in the fellowship hall. We'll have some self-guided crafts, so if you have grandchildren or neighbors that you would like to invite, that's where we'll gather, and we have a bunch of crafts for everybody to do. And then at around 9:45 or so, we will be sending the flocks out to gather Easter eggs. It is a little bit of controlled chaos. We love it that way. If it happens to rain, we will be inside. So there will be an egg hunt no matter what. So we encourage you to bring out your friends, your neighbors, family, and then invite them to stay for worship at 10:30 because we have a very family-friendly worship on Easter. We also, for Thursday and Friday, we're doing something a little different in worship. We're going to be having the sanctuary open for prayer stations. So sometime between Thursday and Friday, the sanctuary space will be open from 9 a.m. to 7 p.m., where you can come in at your own leisure. I'd say probably carve out about an hour of worship, and there will be self-guided stations that are printed. There'll be activities. There'll be reading scriptures. There'll be music. It'll be a nice prayerful time for you just to come and reflect on a lot of the things we're going to talk about this morning about Palm Sunday and where we stand in our faith journey and this closure to Lent. So we're inviting you to come and worship in that way. There won't be any formal evening services at 7. So that's Thursday through Friday. So we encourage you to come out for that. You don't have to be a member of this church to participate in that either. You guys are welcome to invite your neighbors or members of other churches. I know it's hard for people to get out during the week when it's a regular work week, so we encourage you to come out for that. So with that, you guys, you have props. Can I squeeze in here? Mm-hmm. We've got props. What are these things?
Palms.
Palms, okay. And what was all that nonsense about walking in and waving our palms? We don't do that every Sunday, do we?
No. Because the people welcome Jesus by doing that.
Okay. Do you guys want to scoot around here so you can hear us? What, you want to come over here? Come on over here. It looks like a lineup up here. Come on over here. I'm going to show you how to make something. Uh-oh. Because one of the things that we get into Palm Sunday is I get it. We all go to school during the week and we've got work week. So we don't necessarily live and breathe and work at the church like Pastor Beth does, right? So like I'm surrounded by Jesus all week. I get it. You guys are going to be going back to school tomorrow. You got spring break? No. Don't even joke with me.
I have 2 days of school.
Okay. Pastors don't get spring breaks. Off. We don't get them because it's always Easter. But what happens in this week of busyness when you guys go back to your school and your sports and your activities is we kind of forget what happened to Jesus between Palm Sunday and Easter Sunday. And those are two Sundays that we kind of celebrate. So back in Jesus' time, this would be like Party City, okay? What do you guys get at Party City?
Toys.
Streamers, confetti, like things for a party, right? That you would. This was Party City in Jerusalem, 32 AD, okay?
That's why they threw them at Jesus.
Yeah, so this was like what they would have done for streamers. They didn't have a Party City. This was Party City. Okay, and so they celebrated with that. And then next week, if you guys are here to help out and worship, I'm going to be having you guys bring in flowers because we celebrate what on Easter?
Flowers.
Flowers, Jesus' resurrection. Jesus rising from the tomb, right? Jesus is alive. We sing Christ is risen today. But that's kind of confusing when you're like, okay, so we just celebrated him walking into Jerusalem on a donkey with streamers. And then all of a sudden we're at Easter. There's a lot that happens this week, okay? So this parade that Jesus came in on that donkey in Jerusalem didn't end up like the Macy's Day Parade when Santa Claus comes in and everybody's so excited because it's Christmas. It actually ended up with Jesus going into the temple and getting kind of angry. And he went up to some people that were, you know, they were not doing the right thing in the right space at the right time. They were taking advantage of God's house. And Jesus kind of gets angry, and he overturns a bunch of tables and gets mad, and he starts to really make some people angry in Jerusalem. And that's why they start to put him up for trial, and then he gets arrested on Thursday. So there's a lot of things that happen between Palm Sunday and Easter Sunday that we don't celebrate because in our own lives we've gotten so busy. Exactly, that's what we're getting to. So on Thursday, he has dinner with his friends, which we're going to kind of do this morning too. And I'll have those of you guys in the nursery come back in to have communion with us. So he has the Last Supper with his disciples on Thursday night. He goes to the garden to pray, and that's where he's arrested and then tried. And on Friday, they crucify him. And on Good Friday, which is also kind of a confusing way to talk about Jesus dying on a cross, on Good Friday is when Jesus died. So we go from palms to a cross in a matter of 5 days. And that's what these little crosses are, and that's what I've made out of the palms. So I'm going to show you guys how to make these, and then you can practice it either if you go to children's church or... But all you have to do is you're going to fold your cross over, and you're just going to start to fold it until you get something like this, okay? And you're not going to get this on the first try, okay? This has taken me years of practice.
And then keep doing it, like...
Just like maybe 2 or 3 times until you get kind of a stick. Like you're going to fold it 2 or 3 times until you get a stick. Then you're going to hold it kind of in the middle here. And you're going to take the long stem and you're going to fold it over and then you're going to bend it. We'll have lots of people that can help you. I'll probably make at least 10 of these this morning so all of you guys will have one to go home with. Okay?
Like this?
That's okay. You can do it with any of them.
Like this?
It doesn't matter what size it is.
Like this?
Kind of like that. Go down to the middle, though, where you want to fold it. Okay? And then you're going to do it like that. Okay? So watch me.
Like this? What do I do now?
Okay. So watch me. Watch me. And then we're going to... Then you're going to fold it this way until you make a cross. Okay?
That was easy.
That was easy? I will. I said I'll make sure you guys all go home with a cross this morning, okay? And I'm sure that there's some other adults here. Do you know how to, anybody, who knows how to make them? Mr. Kevin's making one right now. We'll have lots of adults that can help you make them too.
I need you to reset
me. Okay, listen, we're going to do one for the whole group, and then by the end of the Sunday morning, everybody will have one to go home with, okay? All right? So
I think I got it.
Now we have a cross, and you're just going to kind of fold your pieces until, and you use it to cross around. That's okay. Like I said, this has taken me years of practice.
I did.
All right. So what you're going to end up having, and you're bending, you have to bend the palm. Like a lot of people are worried about bending the palm, but you have to bend the palm. You have to make creases in it like that to get it to stay. And then once you get to that point, you're just going to start tucking the little ends in until it stays. And it doesn't have to be perfect. It doesn't have to be perfect. But what it means... Okay, go on. Go on. the representation of this is that we did just celebrate with a parade. We just did have a little party because Jesus was coming into Jerusalem, and that was exciting and wonderful for these people because they were waiting and they were expecting Jesus, and they wanted Jesus to come. They thought that Jesus was going to be the answer to all of their prayers. They thought that it was going to be a way that they are, good job. It was a way that they were going to be out from underneath the rule of the Romans. They thought he was there to save them, but it wasn't exactly the way they thought it was going to be. Because at the end of the week, we end up with a cross, and we end up with a crown of thorns, and we end up with nails, and we end up with chains, and Jesus being beaten. And it's not a good thing, right? Mm-mm. So why do we call it Good Friday?
It should be Sad Friday.
It should be Sad Friday, right? But it's Good Friday because what do you think? Why?
Maybe Terrible Friday.
Terrible Friday would be a good one too, yeah?
Is Friday when he got resurrected?
Not Friday. Saturday and Sunday is when we begin to realize that he's resurrected.
Good Friday because the people who wanted Jesus dead named it.
No, we named it. We named it Good Friday because... even though it wasn't what we expected, and we didn't expect Jesus to fulfill our freedom the way that he did, we call it Good Friday because that's when Jesus met all of the sin and death and the bad things in the world on the cross. And when we say that Jesus died for our sins, it's really bigger than that. Jesus died for all of the sins of the world. And when he died on the cross, that's what he was doing. So all the bad things that ever happened or will ever happen in the world, Jesus took care of that and made sure that we would all be able to be with him in heaven someday. And that's why we call it Good Friday. And it's a little confusing, and it's a little, I mean, most of these adults out there are kind of going, huh, as well, because we are always wondering, why do we call it Good Friday? But it's because what Jesus did for us on that day.
I got it.
You got it.
It's not perfect.
You got it. Will you guys pray with me? And then I will, actually I have a few in here. So there's one for you. I will make sure that everybody gets one. Here you go. I will make more, okay? So that's okay. Here, I'll take that one. You take a new one and I'll make one out of this. You've made two, so she's got it. Yep, okay. Let's pray, and then we have children's church, and if you're going to stay, you can go back to your seats with your parents, all right? Okay. Lord God, we give thanks for this day, and we give thanks for challenges that you give us. Even though we don't always figure it out the first time, we know that there is a message in everything that you present for us. And so, Lord, as we struggle with crosses today, help us to also struggle with the questions that we have about your last days here with us. This very human interaction we have with you on Palm Sunday, we give thanks for it because it allows us to celebrate you. And so, Lord, we pray as we continue our worship time together that you continue to reveal yourself through these stories and through this experience of Easter. And all these things, Lord, we pray in your holy name. Amen. All right, if you're going to go to Children's Church, you can go right that way. Miss Gail's going to go with you guys. There's more palms in the thing. You can take as many palms as you want. Take those with you. Go ahead and take them all. Yeah. You can take all of them. Sure.
Wait, can you use this one? That one's
all. Now it's a time in our worship when we offer our gifts to God. If you would bow your heads in prayer. Holy God, sovereign over power and pain, glorious triumph and deep disappointment, we enter this holy week bringing our tithes and offerings to your altar and leaving them here in the hope that you will use them to make the world a more loving and compassionate place. We are reminded through the scripture that you sent two of your disciples out to make the world ready for your coming. Go into the village, find the donkey, tell them the Lord has need. Remind us that your kingdom breaks into the world not as a spectacle for us to witness, but as a parade where we are called to make a working contribution. We pray in the name of the one who comes not just for the parade, but for the cross at the end of it. Amen.
To stand for our doxology.
May be seated. Please join me in the unison prayer of confession. We confess that we are not so different from those who welcomed Christ into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, yet later shouted, "Crucify him," or remained silent in the face of injustice. We have betrayed you too, Lord Jesus, by our sins both secret and known. Yet you died for people like us, and you rose on the third day that we might be redeemed. For the sake of Jesus Christ, do not hold our sins against us. Jesus Christ, our King of glory, we have not been outspoken for you. We have not called for your death, but neither have we shouted of your greatness, nor expressed delight in the salvation you have won for us. Help us to see your glory. Draw us closer to you, that we may become more faithful and more joyful servants of the King.
Lord God, as we continue our prayers, we are reminded by the acts of your Son Jesus that we are forgiven, that we sit in a place of sin and death indeed, but yet we are children, Easter people, children that are forgiven and redeemed by the work of your Son Jesus. And so as we enter into this holy week and we enter into the reflection of his life and his death, we ask, Lord, that you open our hearts, open our minds, open our spirits to receive you in a new and different way. While we mark the loss of children again this week, while we mark a week of unbelievable grief and unrest in our country, as we mark continued change and conflict, we ask, Lord, that you help us to bring light, to bring hope, to bring peace in these places of distress. As we pray this morning, Lord, we pray for families that have lost their children, not just this week in Tennessee, but in the years that have passed since Columbine in 1999. The number of parents that have gone to school and not collected their children is distressing. And so in a week of Easter and a week of holiness, we draw ourselves close to you and find strength and comfort that even in the midst of violence, even in the midst of our disagreements, you are present with those children. You are present through the helpers, through the teachers and the first responders, And Lord, we pray for them too, for the things that they have seen and the acts that they have witnessed. We pray for all of the survivors today, Lord. Lord, you call us to be people who speak your truth and who bring light to the places of darkness. This is what it means to be Easter people. So, Lord, this week, prepare us for this. Prepare us for the ways in which you call us to be the change, which you call us to bring peace and tranquility, which you call us to be your very hands and feet in this world. And so, Lord, we pray for that hope, for that peace, and for that light to be within each one of us as we worship together, and as we remember, and as we continue to push for change in our world. With all these things, Lord, we pray confidently. We pray with hope and strength, as only your Son has taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 21, verses 1 through 11. Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethpage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, the Lord needs them, and he will send them immediately. This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, Tell the daughter of Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey. The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of them, of him, and that followed were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, Who is this? The crowds were saying, This is the prophet, Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Will you pray with me? Lord God, for the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts, may they be acceptable and pleasing to you. Amen. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us be joyful and glad for it. This is a day where we invite the children to come and show us what that Sunday morning would have been like, that Palm Sunday, where the children are waving their palms or their streamers or their branches or whatever it was that they could find. They were excited. They were so happy. They knew that this was something they didn't want to miss out on. And they were singing songs of praise and Hosanna the whole time. And I have to tell you, I'm struggling today. I'm struggling like I've never struggled before to invite our children into this space and ask them to praise and sing songs of Hosanna and wave palm branches. Because this has been yet another day, another week of heartache for those of us that have children, have friends that are teachers, have first responder friends or family members. This is yet another week, and I'm not going to let go of it. I'm not going to not say anything about it because we keep doing that. We keep turning our back on it. We keep saying it's something else, and we're still not responding to it. If any of you follow anything on social media, you've seen the list of names of schools that have had shootings since Columbine. Do you know how long it took me to scroll down that list this week? And we're not immune to it. Frederick High School is on that list. Randallstown High School is on that list. We're not immune. For the first time ever, I watched a young person be interviewed at the University of Michigan who also lived through Sandy Hook. My God, why would I invite children to parade around and sing songs of Hosanna on a day like today? But Palm Sunday is unique out of the whole Holy Week experience. Palm Sunday is a human day. Easter is God's day. Easter is the day, miraculous, light shining, things we cannot even explain with our human construct of mind. Monday, Thursday, Good Friday, those are definitely Jesus days. And you would think that Palm Sunday was a Jesus day too, but in fact, it was a human day. It was a day that humans gathered around God, gathered around Jesus, and praised and thanked him for what they had no idea was about to come. Today is a human day because we have the opportunity to stand as close to Jesus as we ever could. And I'm asking you this week, as part of your Holy Week reflection, is to ask where you stand. In light of everything we've seen in our world today, where do we stand? Do we stand with the children? Do we sing songs of Hosanna with them with hearts pure and open and welcoming? Or do we stand with the Pharisees, questioning and concerned and suspicious? Do we stand with Jesus' friends who also have no idea what's about to come, but they just kind of keep saying to Jesus, hey, there might be a better way of going about this. There might be a better way of coming into Jerusalem knowing what we're about to experience. Or maybe you stand with Rome. Rome, who is the overarching government of this place, and this is simply a place that they are, you know, occupying for the time being, and it's not their problem. It's their problem. Maybe we stand with Rome. Where do you stand? Where do you stand in that parade of Jesus on a colt, on Jesus on a donkey? And yet we come to this parade again. Was this planned? Did Jesus know what he was doing? I mean, we know this whole thing was a prophecy and that Jesus was fulfilling a prophecy that's even written. The donkey is even written about in the prophetic text. So he was fulfilling a prophecy, but when they go to Bethpage or Bethany, he knew these suburbs. So this was kind of like, you know, Baltimore being Jerusalem, Eldersburg or Sykesville or Gambier would have been Bethpage or Bethany. And Jesus was familiar with these subdivisions. He knew the people. He knew where the colt would even be tied up. So was this planned? And who was at the parade? Were it just a couple of people? Was it just half of the people? Was everybody there? Because they all kind of changed their mind throughout the week, and that's the part of the Passion Sunday that we have to be able to sit into. We can't always sit into the things that are comfortable. This parade, as I shared with the kids, it doesn't end with handshakes and high fives and Santa Claus. It ends in violence and upheaval. It ends with Jesus actually committing an act of violence in the temple, overturning tables and telling people this isn't the way it's supposed to be. Through our Lent series this season, we did the movie Chocolat, which was a lovely film about a beautiful French village. I hope you guys had a chance to at least watch the movie while we've been doing this. But we had two studies, one in the morning and one in the evening on Tuesdays. And we tied that devotional Lenten study up this week. And it kind of concluded at the end where this village that had had all of these differences and had all of this upheaval and had all of this really refusing to move, refusing to change, refusing to accept new and different ways. And at the end, they finally embrace this. And it's not comfortable. Embracing change and embracing the world and changing ourselves, it's not comfortable. If you've lived long enough, you've had to do some change. And I want you to think about that change, whether it was a mindset or something that you actually changed about yourself or the way that you live. It's hard. It's uncomfortable. And that's what these people, they literally transformed their community and lived into a new meaning of tranquility, which was what they were looking for. They described their little village of never changing as being a place of utter tranquility until someone moved in and turned it upside down. And it took this entire village to begin to open themselves up and change and move and literally transform who they were as a people, in order to truly live out what it means to live in tranquility. It required an upheaval. It required protest. It required differences being hashed out, which is never comfortable. I hate, and I don't like to use that word very often, I hate conflict. I don't really know anybody that does, unless you're really good at addressing conflict. Then maybe you have some masochistic experience and you really like it when there's conflict involved. I'm sure that there are people out there like that, but I really am uncomfortable with conflict. But sometimes we have to have that in order to reach what we are looking for: peace and closeness with God. Change can be so incredibly powerful, but it can also be uncomfortable. It has to happen, though, in order for us to reach a place of tranquility and peace. And so what was Jesus bringing that parade Sunday as far as peace goes? As far as this Palm Sunday, as far as this Passion Week that we're about to live through? And again, his disciples are all sitting there going, hey, I think there might be a safer way to get into Jerusalem where nobody would know we were going to be there. Like, I know this guy has a back door that we could kind of just go in the back gate. They'll never know we're there. You can still go and do your thing. But that's not what was required. Jesus knew what was required. Jesus knew his presence needed to be seen. Jesus knew it was time to claim who he was. So as we reflect on where we sit, whether it's the passion or whether it's our current state of affairs in this country, where do we sit? And maybe this Palm Sunday isn't so much about asking those questions of ourselves, but listening. This week, I listened as a group of Gen Z, meaning our younger people, some of who don't yet have the right to vote but will, march on the state capitol of Tennessee in a peaceful protest where legislation continues to be passed that removes gun restrictions and laws. Now, we are so fortunate living in the state of Maryland, we have good gun laws. We have a relatively safe place of our politicians and our mindset. But there are a lot of places in our country that are not, and we know this. So we, as people of faith, cannot ignore the things that are going on in our world. We have to be able to speak out because that's what Jesus models for us. That's what Jesus' hope brings to us. And those voices of those young people are the people that we need to be listening to, because this is their world and we're just living in it. So my friends, if you think you're a person of faith, you have to pay attention to what's going on around us and reflect sincerely on what change needs to happen within you, what change needs to happen within our communities and our culture and our societies and our world in order for us to be part of that change. And I'll give you a spoiler alert. It's not comfortable. It's not comfortable. But there is hope in these voices. There is hope, and there is joy, and there is peace, and there is tranquility. We know how to get there. We just can't stand by and watch and hope. We have to be part of it. And that's what Jesus was telling his disciples. That's why they didn't take the back gate. That's why they didn't avoid the conflict. They knew. And we do too. Deep down, each and every one of us knows what needs to happen. So this week, I invite you into this time of holiness, into this time of passion, into this time of care and comfort for one another. Reach out to one another. Tell them you love them. Tell them you are their friend. Tell them you care for them, and listen to the voices of our young people. Listen to them, because they have far more wisdom than we do at this point. Will you pray with me? Lord God, we give thanks for this day and for the reminder of your presence with us, through us, and in us. As we come to the table this morning, let it be a place of healing and wholeness. As we share of this loaf and of this cup, remind us of that act in which you shared with your disciples this great Thanksgiving. We call upon you, Lord, to bring us peace, to bring us comfort and prayer and change in this week. And all these things, Lord, we pray in your holy name. Amen. As we gather for communion this morning, I remind you this table is not my table. It's not Calvary's table. This is the Lord's table. So anyone and everyone is invited to partake in our communion this morning. We give thanks in this time of Lent as we reflect on this act on Thursday, where Jesus would have gathered with his disciples in that upper room. You'll receive in your hand, so come forward with your hand extended by the ushers. They will place a piece of bread and a grape in your hand. Return to your seat, don't eat the grape or the piece of bread yet, and we will receive communion together as one body. So will you pray with me? Lord, we give thanks and praise to you because it is a right and a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks. Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth, in love you made us for yourself. And when we have fallen away into sin and become subject to evil and death, your love has always remained steadfast. You bid your faithful people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Easter feast, that renewed by your word and sacraments and in fervent in prayer and in works of justice and mercy, we may come to the fullness of grace that you have prepared for those who love you. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus, whom you sent in the fullness of time to redeem the world. He emptied himself, taking the form of a servant. Being born in our likeness, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. He took upon himself our sin and death and offered himself a perfect sacrifice for the sin of the whole world. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. Lord, we invite you to pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here and on these gifts, that in the breaking of this bread and the sharing of this cup, we may be for the world the body and blood of Christ for this world, redeemed by his Spirit until he comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. I invite my servers to come forward. As your word became flesh, born of a woman on that night so long ago, on the night that he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you, Lord, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. Again, he gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and drink. This is the blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen.